What did we look at last class? We looked at the... Okay, silence please. We looked at last class, we looked at what happens when you have a cascade of single pole amplifiers. That was just because we considered single pole systems, I just decided to do that, and I know you have done dominant pole systems, right? And we found out what the overall bandwidth is. Now once we find the overall bandwidth, you can actually optimize, right? You can find out if you require a certain bandwidth and a certain overall gain, how many stages do you need, right? You can optimize for that. So in other words, you're going to solve for n. I'm not going to do that in class. I leave it for your reference. Just go through the notes. It's very straightforward. Okay? But what I wanted to do today was, we looked at, let's just quickly look at the summary of frequency response, right? Poles and zeros. So we looked at how you find the different poles and zeros. So one case we looked at was you could have LHP or RHP zeros depending on, so you could have plus or minus GM with a capacitor. Correct? This is one case we looked at. Now I just want you to note that this is not the only way that zeros are created. Okay? This just happens to be one example which I gave, okay, in one of the couple of classes ago. Zeros can be created in actually several ways, and if you have a case like this, you can be fairly sure that you are going to get a zero. There are other cases where it may not be so obvious, but you do get a zero. So today we will look at two other cases, okay, where you can get zeros without having something explicit capacitances like this, okay. And then we looked at, so you, if you have some, okay, so let me correct that a little bit. Let me just make it GI and CI. So you'll get something at minus GI over CI. You'll get an LHP pole. Okay? And somebody was asking when you get RHP poles. Right? Even that you can see from this. So, and I think who mentioned that you could have instability in typically, right? You see RHP poles and the system is unstable. You can actually see that here. So what happens is, when you have a real impedance at the node, sorry, when you have a positive impedance GI, you'll get an LHP pole. If you get a negative impedance, you'll get an RHP pole. Okay? So in other words, and negative impedances are typically created when you have positive feedback. Okay, you don't, off the top of your head, it's not obvious. There are not many circuits where you have, you know, negative impedances, right? So you need to have some specific situations where you would have negative impedances, and that's when you create RHP poles. Okay? Okay, so let's look at zeros in a little bit more detail, right? So the original case, so let's say you have a minus GM, you have a CZ across the input output, and let's say for, you also have some G out and some CL. Okay. Now you can calculate the input output transfer function. Run your KVL, KCL, right? In this case, KCL. Okay, you can write V out as I out times Z out. Okay, and Note that diode has two components. Okay? One component is through the transconductance stage. The other component is through your capacitor. Okay? And you'll see that there are several cases where this is a common factor, where you have multiple paths to the output. Okay? When you have multiple paths to the output, quite often you'll have a zero. In this case, let's write it as Y out times V out. Okay? Equals, how do you want to write it? This is the best way? Yeah. Gm Vn. So this is one component. Y out times V out is nothing but I out. So minus Gm Vn is one component. Plus Vn minus V out times SEZ. Right? Y out is nothing but SEL plus G out. Now you can combine and now you can write V out over VS. You'll get something like this once you combine. This is your familiar expression. You already expected that. You have one pole, which is G out with CL and CZ. The zero depends on GM over CZ. Correct? Okay. So now, there are other cases where you can have presence of zeros. I'll show you a simple example. This is actually slightly more general case of let's take the case where your input to output, right, has two paths. One is just a proportional path. In the other case, you have a single pole. Okay, now if you calculate your input-output response, what is V out of S? K1 V in of S. Plus K2 over 1 plus S over omega P times V in of S. So your V out over V in of S is going to be K1 Do you see where the zero is coming from? Right? You get something like this. Okay? Where your omega z is omega p times k1 plus k2 over k2. Okay? This is another case where it's not, you know, you don't see a capacitance between input and output directly. It just happens to come as a sum of different paths. Okay? So this is one case, and you'll see something similar. Let's take an example of this, right? So let's take an example which you're all familiar with, which is a differential pair with a current mirror load. You've all studied that in your analog electronic circuit. Yes. Kevin Prasuk, yeah, you're right. Yeah, thanks for the correction. Yeah. Okay. Now if you look at this, okay, I'm gonna call this IT. And let's assume you have two paths. Okay, I mean you have two cases where the pole is significant. One is at the output, the other is at this node. I'm gonna call this node X. Okay, how many paths to the output do you have? This is one path, this is the second path, right? Do you see that? If you go through path, the blue path, how many poles do you see on the way? Only one pole, which is the output pole, right? If you go through the other path, how many poles do you see? You'll see two poles, one at X and one at the output. Now the output signal, I mean the overall output is just going to be the sum of these two. So this is similar to the previous case, right? Just a more like detailed case, I would say. Okay? So if you call this as, I'm going to call this omega p2, I'm going to call this omega p1 at the output. Okay? What is omega p1? It's just GDS1 plus GDS3 over CL. Okay? And it's a left half plane pole. What is omega p2? What is it? Yeah, I'm calling the whole capacitance there Cx. Right? I'm calling the whole capacitance at node X as Cx. Okay, it could come from CGS of M3, CGS of M4, right? CdB of M1. All good. What is the pole frequency? What is it? Right. So it's minus GM3 over CX. Right? That's the impedance. Overall impedance is going to be dominated by GM3. Right? Overall conductance, sorry, not impedance. Okay? This is omega p2. Now if you have two paths, now you can write the output voltage as sum of the two paths, you will get the same thing. Okay, you will get the same thing as before. So through path 1, so let me call this path 1. Yes. Yeah, I just wrote it as GDS1 and GDS3. It's the same. I'm assuming they're identical, right? So, GDS1 is GDS2, GDS3 is GDS4. Okay, similarly GM1 is GM2, GM3 is GM4. It would have been more accurate to just call it, you know, GDSN plus GDSP probably. Okay. Let me just do it this way. Okay? you have some gain A naught through path 1. This is through path 1. Through path 2 you are going to have okay. And similarly, if you add the two, you get the common factor A0 over 1 plus S over omega P1. Okay? Okay? What does this turn out to be? Right, you get 1 plus correct okay, so now you have a zero, right, created just because there is a second part. Okay, so this I just did just to make sure, don't always assume that there is no zero. Okay, we are going to come to, so next we are going to look at diff pairs in a little bit more detail, frequency response, and you will see that this dual path is these two are not the only ways, there are other ways where you can have zeros. So we'll look at the third way, okay, next, when we start analyzing diff pairs. If the two paths are not identical and have different sets of poles and poles, yeah, definitely you will, right? The two paths have different sets of poles, you'll definitely get zeros, there's no doubt about it, okay? But, so the first way we looked at was input-output capacitance, that is actually a subset of dual path. Right? The other case we looked at is a more general, any general dual path. Third one we are going to look at where there is no input-output capacitance, there is no dual path, but you still get a zero. Okay, we are going to look at that now, not immediately, but in a little, you know, in a few minutes, maybe 10 minutes or so. Okay? So the main thing is to remember is that zeros are not always obvious. Okay? So we are going to assume there is some output capacitance CL. Okay. You have a tail current source IT. And now we want to go into a little bit more detail. The tail current source is going to have an output impedance. Okay. RT. And a capacitance CT. Okay? Okay? So now you know how to do, we can write the differential mode half circuit, calculate the differential mode gain, common mode half circuit, common mode gain. Okay, let's quickly do that, see what it looks like. So, first the differential mode half circuit. VOD, and for simplicity for now I'll assume that device capacitance are small, okay, because now we already have two poles. Let us just see what happens. So G out is GDS plus GD. It's pretty straightforward. Right, minus GM over G out is the low frequency gain. And this is your frequency component. Okay? Pretty straightforward. This is like a common source. So if you plot this, it looks something like this. So let us say I'm going to plot. It looked like a single pole response. Well and good. Right? There's nothing special about this. Let's look at the common mode response. Okay? What does the common mode half circuit look like? What all do you have in the common mode half circuit? You'll have 2RT and CT by 2, right? And after that, you can take, you know, M1, RD, CL for 1/2, right? Very straightforward. So input common mode is VIC. CL, this is VOC, okay? So now, for simplicity, I'm going to call this ZS, okay? 2RT and CT over 2, I'm going to call it ZS, that's at the source, okay? What is ZS? Correct? ZS is just 2RT over 1 plus CTRT. To calculate gain, easy way to do it. Write the overall effective transconductance of this combination. We know this is a ZS which is degenerating M1. You can write the overall transconductance. What is that? GM over 1 plus GM ZS. Right? Okay? Yes. No. What are you going to do? You want something for the common mode. You want something which is the same on both sides, right? You're going to split this RT as 2RT, 2RT in parallel. The CT, you're going to split it as CT by 2, CT by 2 in parallel. Right? Resistors become half, capacitors double when you have them in parallel. Okay? Then you are going to take half, 1/2 of the circuit and analyze. Right? That's how you do common mode analysis, right? That's how you have been taught to do. Okay? And now you can, you know, put in ZS inside this. So you can put in here, okay? So you get it as, so now ZS has 1 plus CTRT in the denominator, you're going to get that in the numerator, over. Okay? So now do you see where the zero is coming from? Right? Now all you are going to do is take this GM and transconductance and multiply it with the output impedance. Right? So because you happen to have a ZS in the source, that is giving you a zero. Okay? There are multiple ways to look at this. We'll see, you know, different ways to look at how a zero is formed in this case. But let's do the analysis first. Okay. Now we want to write it as, again, the low frequency gain times zeros over poles. That's how we want to write everything. What is the low frequency gain? This is your low frequency transconductance. Times 1 over G out. This is your low frequency common mode gain. Okay? So in this case you are going to get some zero. And you are definitely going to get two poles. Why are you going to get two poles? One from ZS, that is here, the other from Z out. Right? You're going to get two poles. And you can also write what these values are going to be. You already know what omega Z is. Okay? Going to be minus 1 over RTCT. Okay, so this is going to be a left half plane zero. That is just coming directly from this. Okay, what are the other two poles? Let's take omega P1 from the output pole. What is that? It's just going to be minus G out over CL. So this is a left half plane pole. Okay? What is the other pole you get? From this, right? What is the position of the pole? Right? It's just 1 plus 2 GMRT over CTRT. Okay? And of course this is a minus. This is also a left half plane pole. And you can simplify this further, because what do you know? You know that RT is the output impedance of the current source. Normally you expect that to be high. So you can say 2 GMRT is going to be much greater than 1. You can simplify this further. You can write it in this form. Okay? So it just becomes 2GM, minus 2GM over CT, write it as minus GM over CT by 2. Why do I want to write it in this form? What is the pole at the source? It's the impedance at the source, like conductance at the source over the capacitance at the source. What is the capacitance at the source? CT over 2. What is the conductance? It's 1 over 2RT in parallel with 1 over GM. You assume that RT is very large, right? So it's just going to be 1 over 2RT plus 1 over, GM plus, the total conductance is going to be GM plus 1 over 2RT. You've already applied the condition saying 2 GMRT is much greater than 1. Okay? So in other words, it's just going to be 1 over GM. So impedance there. Conductance is going to be GM. So it's just GM over CT over 2. Right? That is also pretty straightforward. okay? And that's because now you can also look at it in a slightly different way. So another way to look at it is, if RT is large enough, you can look at this as a source follower. Okay, from get to source. Okay, this will be an approximate analysis, it won't be exact. Okay, and you'll see why. Suppose you assume this is like a source follower. Then you apply VIC here, at the source you again get the IC. Okay, actually let's look at what happens. Okay, so I'm going to assume that this is a source follower. So I'm going to say VS approximately equal to VIC. Okay, now I can calculate, that means that VIC directly comes here. I can calculate what current is being drawn by this impedance, right, IS. Is nothing but Vs over Zs. Okay, Vs is Vic. What is Zs? 1 over Zs is nothing but 1 over 2 RT plus SCT over 2. Correct? 1 over Zs is just Ys. Ys is nothing but 1 over 2 RT plus SCT over 2. Correct? What is VOC? Nothing but IS times, minus IS times Z out. Correct? Okay, now we can calculate the common mode gain, VOC over VIC. Let's see what this approximate analysis gives us. Let me make a... Okay, this, remember this is an approximate analysis, you'll see why. We just did the complete analysis, so we know what the poles and zeros are. What does this give us? You're going to get, so minus Z out times 1 over RT plus SCT over 2. Z out is this, minus R out over, sorry, R out over 1 plus STL R out. This is Z out. Okay, again what we are going to do is write it as a low frequency value times zeros over poles. Minus of R out over 2 RT. Okay. What do you get from this? If you cross multiply the term, the bracket here, you get SCT RT. That is your zero. Okay? So it's given you omega z and omega p1. Okay? But it's not given you omega p2. And that kind of makes sense, right? You know, normally we neglect any pole which comes in parallel with your input. Right? And that's what you have done. You have basically assumed that the input completely appears across RTCT combination. You will never see this pole. Okay? Actually, there are other ways when you can look at, you can see why there is a zero formed here. Yeah, I mean, typically if you have a pole, if you have, let's say you have a capacitance here, right? Normally, since it appears directly across the input, you would ignore it, right? In this case, since you are assuming that it's a source follower, input is directly coming here, you will not see a pole there, okay? I mean, there is no direct intuition, but that is just the, that is, I think that's a decent way to look at it. How do you find out when a circuit has zeros? What is the important thing that happens when you have a zero? There are actually two ways when you can find out. When you can, correct. So I mean, not ground V out. In other words, V out goes to zero at a particular frequency. Okay. If you ever have V out going to zero at a particular frequency, you definitely have a zero. Okay. In this case, you can see what happens. When will V out go to zero? You can. That will happen when all the signal current just circulates between these two. Okay? So if this is Vs, Vs over RT is the current through this. That is equal to Vs over 2RT is the current through this. That should be the negative of SCT over 2 times Vs. That will give you, you can put S equals J omega, you can solve for omega. Okay? So that is easy way to look at it. Okay. So if the output ever goes to zero at any time, okay. Anything else? If you have a zero, what happens to the gain? So that's the first one. Okay, that's a very good observation. V out goes to zero at the zero frequency. Okay, what is the other thing you know? What happens to the magnitude? What happens to the gain if you have a zero? Gain actually increases 20 dB per decade for every zero. Right? So if you have a case where, let us say you expected gain to be constant, and suddenly gain starts increasing, you can expect a zero. Okay? Simple examples. So, let us go back to this case. What is the gain at low frequencies? Okay, assume that there's no CL, okay? If you want to look at the gain, it doesn't directly depend on CL. If you just want to compare at low frequencies and high frequencies. So you can just look at the transconductance. If you're going to plot the transconductance of this whole thing versus frequency, what is it going to look like? At low frequencies, what is the transconductance? GM over 1 plus 2 GM RT, which is approximately 1 over RT, okay? Okay, I know that at very low frequencies, 1 over RT, okay, what happens at very high frequencies, what is the transconductance at very high frequencies, it is just GM, because this capacitor is going to short out your source, so you are just going to get GM, and we already know, we've already assumed that. What does this mean? Correct? you're going to get something like this. Okay? You're getting an increase in the transconductance. That itself shows that you should expect a zero there. Okay, even if it's not directly obvious from looking at the circuit. Okay, so those are just different ways. I mean, I just wanted to tell you because since we considered only zeros with capacitors across, there are other ways. Okay? Now, if you go back to this, I want you to read section 6.6 from Razavi's textbook. Okay? That tells you a little bit more about this in a little bit more detail. It does the full analysis. Okay? It, you know, in detail calculates what is pole at CX, CL, calculates the overall gain, does the whole analysis. So this one is called a mirror pole. Okay? But basically you get a second pole there at CX. Okay? So now we talked about differential gain, differential mode gain, common mode gain. Okay? So now you can define something called CMRR. People have heard about CMRR? Right, the common mode rejection ratio. Okay? CMRR and dB can be defined as 20 log ADM over ACM. Differential mode gain over common mode gain. What is it at low frequencies? Differential mode gain is nothing but GM over G out. So, yeah. Common mode gain is just R out over 2RT. 1 over 2RT is the transconductance times R out is your gain. R out is just 1 over G out. Okay? It's just 20 log GMRT. Oh, sorry. 2 GMRT. Okay? So now if you want very high CMRR, you definitely know what to do. Okay? Important thing is to maximize the output impedance of the current source. Okay? If you have a really ideal current source, CMRR is infinite. Okay? Just be careful about this definition because I think Razavi's textbook defines it a little bit differently. And that is actually wrong. So he actually defines it in terms of the mismatch. Okay, that is not the way it is usually done. Okay, because in Razavi's case, he gives the common mode gain as, so in other words, because you have two common mode paths, right? Ideally, if you have no mismatch, he says that it should be proportional to delta in the GM. Okay, that is not actually true. It actually depends on RT rather than delta in the GM. Okay, if you have finite RT, you are going to have finite CMRR. Okay? So that is your low frequency. And now, what happens to your, let's go back to our common mode and differential mode gain has one pole. Okay? Common mode gain has 1-0, two poles. Okay? So if you plot the overall CMRR, what do you expect actually? If you want high CMRR, you actually want a low common mode gain, right? That is what gives you high CMRR. And what you already know, at high frequencies, what happens? Already you know that this capacitance is going to short out CTO2. You are going to get a larger transconductance. You are going, the zero is going to come in and cause you to get an increased common mode gain. In other words, a decreased TMRR. Okay? So that is one big effect of the zero. So you'll start seeing things like this. So you'll see a very drastic drop in TMRR at higher frequencies. Okay? Okay, because the zero increases the gain at 20 dB per decade. Okay, just keep that in mind. And the other thing to keep in mind is the definition of TMRR. Okay, don't go by the Razavi definition. That is not correct. Okay, any other textbook you find, it will give you the other definition. Okay, which is you take each half circuit and compare the two. Sorry? Sure. Exactly, I have not shown that here. I have just shown you, the thing is, what you'll have to do is find out the relative positions of the poles and zeros. Okay, the fact of the matter is, the zero is R2, I mean, 1 over RTCT. Okay, so remember, RT is large. You are designing it to be very large. In other words, the zero is the one which is going to cause you to, so what will happen is, the zero is the one which is going to appear first. Because RT is very large. So you'll start dropping CMRR and high frequency much before. Later, you might increase, but you don't care by that time. You've already lost CMRR, you can't use the circuit quite often. Okay? So that is another. Because RT is high. Okay?